But before we officially kick this off, I would like to invite our director, Scott Cooley, up here to say just a few quick words before we break into our meeting.
Cool.
No, I'm going to be really brief. But I just, again, want to thank all of you guys. I think I thanked you all when you had your first kickoff meeting. I want to thank you again. We're really starting to get into the implementation of the levy in now, and we're ramping up as a department and trying to wrap our brain around how much we bid off. And I really look forward to you guys helping us learn how to communicate that work to the general public. So as you are going through this process, you guys are holding us accountable. And so nine years from now, we're going to be sitting in front of City Council talking about how we delivered on the Seattle levy. And it'll be really helpful for you guys to make sure that we are communicating what we're doing in a clear way, keeping our priorities in order, and making sure that everything that we're talking about are committed to that we're delivering on. So I think it takes a little bit of time to get ramped up, and I think that's one of the things that we're learning right now as a department is this was a really big ramp up to get started. And so, but I think you're starting to see some really good work. I don't know if you guys have noticed, but we've been combining our Bridging the Gap work with restriping a ton of different crosswalks around downtown so that we can improve accessibility. And so you should see a couple hundred brand new white crosswalks, one right outside this building. So it's actually starting to come. It's actually starting to roll. Yes, look at the bridge. It's under construction. Is one of the Bridging the Gap projects. So there's real big projects and small projects that are starting to get up. Thank you guys. And I'm happy if you guys have any questions for me about your evening commute or any other issues. I'm happy to answer right now.
Did you walk me on Fifth Avenue this morning?
No, I was like O'Brien.
All right. So jumping into tonight's agenda, thank you all for coming. Thank you for taking time out of your day. We've got some new stuff to cover, and then we're going to go over the Neighborhood Street Fund. But before we get started, I did want to have everybody take a look at the agenda. Since it's a public meeting, I want to make sure everyone approves. And let me know if you'd like to add anything, hopefully not subtract anything, because we have some people here to present. But seeing nothing, I'm Betty.
Are you going to give us an update on where we are organizing-wise and that kind of thing? We talked about that at the last meeting.
Yes. Yeah. Yep, that's at that the next steps. Yep, okay. Exactly.
And Elliot, can you introduce the people from Muldoon?
Yes, we should. Why don't we actually, since this is only our second meeting, why don't we go around the table here, the committee table, just say your name, who you are, and then we'll kind of go around and say who's in the room watching. So why don't we start with you?
Elizabeth Kiker.
I'm Nick Paranjpye.
Hi, I'm Joe Laubach, and my favorite 80s movie is Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Just a
I'm Ron Boston. I like that movie, but I'm here representing the transit.
I'm Pat Cohn, representing the Seattle Freedom Advisory.
Shefali Ranganathan.
Brian Estes.
Paul Muldoon with the Pedestrian Advisory Board. Alex Krieg.
Hi, I'm Esther over Transportation.
I'm Megan Hoyt. I'm in ESTAT, and I'll be speaking to you about the Neighborhood Street Fund.
I'm Kristen Simpson, also with ESTAT.
My name is Chloe Johnson. I'm an
SDOT
in finance.
Christian Diaz, SDOT, and I am in finance.
Kevin Lowe, SDOT, also in finance.
Torger Erickson, citizen and transportation engineer.
Genesee Adkins, I'm at SDOT. I'm in the director's office.
Rob Gorman, HDR consultant.
Ann McKinney, WSP Parsons Pickard Hall consultant.
Chris Johnson, Parsons Transportation Group, very interested consultant.
Lisa Galassini, interested citizen.
Mike O'Brien, City Council.
Great, thank you everybody. And now is our opportunity for public comment. So does anyone in the room, would you like to say anything? Just the group? Didn't have anyone sign up. Okay, All right, well, with that, we will go ahead and kick this meeting off. These are our mission and core values, and I include them in case anyone is watching online after we put these materials up. But since you guys see them every time, I'm going to slide right by it tonight.
Except we can't. They're not
through you.
That's a problem. So for our meeting tonight, we're going to go over our quarter one and quarter two financials and accomplishments, which I'm really excited to share with all of you. And then we're going to do a short preview and update on our levy leveraging, since many of our accomplishments are dependent on a lot of leveraging over the 9 years. My colleague Kristen Simpson is going to present to you on some of that work. And then Megan Hoyt is going to present on the Neighborhood Street Fund. You play a central role in that, and that's really kicking off. It's been going on for several months, but your work is going to be kicking off here in the next month or so. And then we're going to talk about breaking into Neighborhood Street Fund subcommittees. In the past, the Oversight Committee has broken into groups and looked at those projects and then selected them. So it worked well in the past, and we'd like to kind of continue on that path again. And then we're going to talk about next steps, and that's our organizing, and then we also need to formalize the process of selecting a chair and co-chairs. So we'll get to that at the end. Before I switch over to the next slide, I'm going to pass some handouts around real quickly. These are our quarter one and quarter two financials and accomplishments. You can pass them around the room. But before we break into them, what I really wanted to do, and why I invited some members of our finance team to come here and speak tonight, is because this is the first meeting where you guys are going to be looking at the levy financials. And I wanted to sort of start with a broad overview of how we put our SDOT budget together. The levy money is a significant, levy funds are a significant portion of the SDOT budget, but it's not the entire budget. So here is our 2016 budget, and you'll see the different breakdown there. O&M, some explanations for those. The O&M is our operations and maintenance, and the CIP stands for our capital improvement program. So those are our bigger capital projects. And we break that budget down annually. It looks a little different each year, but what we wanted to stress and get across to everybody is that it takes many different sources and many different funds going to our SDOT budget.
What's reimbursable?
I'm going to pivot to Chloe on what's a reimbursable.
Okay, so there's a couple of different ways that we might do work and reimburse for it. We do some work on behalf of the sales we like and SPU, and that's considered to be reimbursable. Our crews will go out and do work. What else?
We also do any reimbursable work, say utility cuts, working with other contractors and other departments in terms of work that is being requested on behalf of SDOT, but funded by an external source, not by an internal SDOT source.
And question, Ellie, the levy portion is in this budget, correct?
Yes, correct.
And that's the next slide. So, bringing that circle down, where our 2016 money is coming from, you'll see the Moose Seattle levy budget, and then all of our other different funding sources. So, when we talk about our levy accomplishments and our deliverables, just for example, if we're talking about our 20 miles of paving that we're doing this year. That's not, each accomplishment isn't necessarily all levy funded. It can take into account multiple different sources. So what you'll see over the next several slides is we're coupling all those different fund sources together, showing you that it takes multiple different sources to get to the accomplishments that the levy and the legislation calls for. And this will also be made clear in our leveraging slide where we kind of break it out as well. But with this, the purpose of this slide and the purpose of starting this way is to really start at the top, start with a broad picture of the entire SDOT budget and how that works together to get us what we promised in Move Seattle.
Ellie, what's DLF?
DLF
is the vehicle license fee, paid when you pay your car tax. So that's the STBD, the $20 Seattle Transportation Benefit, the $20 car tax fee. Prop 1 is the $60 car tax fee in addition to the 1-1 sales tax that was passed years back.
So what I find surprising, the general fund at $44 million, so less than 10% of SDOT's money comes from the general fund. That's a lot smaller than I thought it would be.
Correct.
That's correct.
So we have multiple different colors of money in terms of relying on a lot of different sources of partnerships, grants, bonds, other opportunities to do a lot of the work that we do every day.
Did that proportion change dramatically with MOVE-CL? I mean, did we become more reliant on the levy funding?
I would say that in terms of, like, for example, general fund support, it's been in line. The reliance on other sources of funding has always been there. Bridging the gap, for example, was about $45, $42 million a year when we had that levy. But the reliance in terms of the proportion of the proposed money has always been this proportion.
Any other questions? All right, so, are there any extra handouts? All right, so very top level here. All of you guys are familiar with our different levy categories: safe routes, maintenance and repair, and then congestion relief. So as of June 30th, 2016, this is where we currently stand with our total expenditures. You'll see them broken down into each different category. We're going to break that down further, and it's on your handout as well, what each of those categories' different spending is. What you might notice on this chart is that both of those columns are the same. That is intentional. It's not an error. But we wanted to show you that we are tracking levy expenditures throughout the course of the levy. So this year, those two columns are going to be identical. Once we get into year two, that second column is going to look different. And so this is total expenditures. So taking a step back, this is looking at all of our different fund sources going into what it takes to get those safe routes accomplishments delivered, what it takes to get those maintenance and repair accomplishments delivered, and congestion relief as well. So if you look at our total spending year to date, we're at our actual spending is a little under $50 million, and we're projected to spend in our budget $240 million this year. Again, that's all sources. What I will note is historically, we spend about a third of our budget in the first half of the year. SDOT spends a third of it there. Then they spend their other two-thirds in the last half, largely due to when you can actually do your construction projects. They're in the summer. If you look at it, we can't do paving, we can't do a lot of road work, which makes up a significant portion of our budget when it's cold and rainy. So those numbers are going to start and have been starting to move a lot in July. They're just not reflected here yet. And what I will say then too is that, like Director Cooley mentioned, is that this is a ramp up year as well. So what we're used to seeing and sort of projected to seeing is lower spending than maybe what you would typically see at that third percentage, or at that 30% in a year that's later than the first year of the levy. So any questions about this chart or this graph? Yep, Ron?
Is your approved budget, you have to have approved budget to do work, so I'm just thinking that maybe the approved budget's always going to be a little bit larger than your actual cash flow, because if you don't have the authority to spend, you don't even start the work? Or is it a cash flow authorization?
So that is correct. That the budget is always going to be a little bit ahead of what we may manage to spend in a given year, because we have to have the authority when we go to add on contract.
Right.
We have to have the budget in place and then add, and then it,
So you might see multi-year expenditure from the budget before you get the single year.
There's a lag.
And I think that is actually something that would be good for us to highlight for people, so they don't think you're so far behind.
Yep.
So the other thing I would ask for is the ramp up seems like it should have not been that much, only because of you had bridging the gap. And I know when we were closing bridging the gap down, they were doing multiple scenarios of, presuming that the replacement levy would be passed, hopefully. So it seems like it wasn't like a brand new levy. So ramp up, maybe there are different kinds of projects or something, but hopefully the ramp up wasn't like you starting from nothing, which was a big deal last time around.
Yeah. No, it definitely, I would say it wasn't starting from nothing. Like Director Cooley mentioned, it's a larger levy. So it's you're used to functioning at this level, and it's getting it up to that higher level. So it's not starting from nothing, but it is recognizing that a lot of these projects are design heavy too, and you just don't really spend that money while you're in that design phase. You spend it in your construction phase. So
it's also one of the things that, you know, one of the real great things about bridging the gap was new systems were, you know, I think there were some real institutional changes made within the department to be able to do this.
Yeah.
So hopefully that's been taken advantage of.
Yeah, definitely. And I will say it's a little bit difficult to draw too many connections, you know, when you're, this is our first report, I think you'll really be able to see it sort of going forward, seeing if there are any longer term trends or anything you see.
So when I'm looking at this, I'm looking at a year to date and a life of levy, the numbers are identical.
Yep. So that was just, we wanted to show our intention that starting in year two, the life of the levy means from when it passed to when it's going. So that second column will look differently starting in year two, but this whole year is gonna be the same. We kind of had an internal discussion, we were like, do we include it? That's kind of silly to have too, but we wanted to let you guys know that that column, you know, and that projection is going to be there with us the entire time, so we're watching how we're spending.
So just so I understand that, so proportionally, assuming that those categories are proportional year after year, in year two, that safe routes number will double in terms of life of the levy, because you're in year, like I'm not tracking. And the other part that I'm trying to, sorry if I'm slow, this is all expenditures or is it just levy expenditures?
All expenditures.
But so just to clear up one point though, you know, he put the total SDOT budget up there for reference. This is only, what you're seeing is only projects funded with Move Seattle funding, right? So this isn't everything that SDOT is doing.
Wait, but my question is, I mean, Move Seattle raises what, about 100 million? I can't remember.
Yep.
Right, but that doesn't add up, right? So
nope.
There's...
There are other, this is general fund, this is all the other sources that you saw on the previous
so
slide.
So it's any project that Move Seattle touches.
Correct, right.
Okay.
Yes.
Correct.
But then the funding sources
with other, eligible. Correct.
Because what we'll get to with the next slide is the reason we do want to start with this, and we can kind of, I'm happy to like get your feedback, and I want to know what makes sense to all of you guys when we're talking about this and showing it. But what we wanted to also recognize is that the accomplishments that we're getting and that you'll see on the next slide are the result of not just levy funds. And we wanted to make sure that people knew that very clearly, that it's not just the levy funding everything. We felt it was a little disingenuous to say we've paved this many roads or something and not taken into account the other fund sources.
That's about 150% more than what it generates each year, right?
All right. It's matching funds.
So well, again,
but it's probably mostly SDOT sources of non-levy. If you have 240 and you only have 95 a year levy revenue, so it's quite a bit.
Oh, he's all the sources that get you to 240. Yeah, exactly. The levy makes up that portion of it.
What's the total SDOT budget then?
491. 491. But there are things that aren't levy funded. So these are only.
So the sentence is, out of a $491 million budget, $240 million has either been affected by or helped by the Move Seattle levy, which funds $95 million each year?
Yep.
Correct.
So it's like
easy
matching
one,
funds.
One, two, three. What?
It's like matching funds. It's all mix.
So then, Elliot, maybe to clarify, it would be good to have some kind of chart on that intermediate step,
mm-hmm.
like how the 240 is constituted.
Yes.
Because we kind of know this stuff and we don't get it, so the general public might be behind us. And also, on this year-to-date, it might be good to put a 2016 year-to-date and life of, you know, Moving Seattle. You got more than one levy.
Yep.
So the year-to-date budget, $240 million, that is only 6 months of budget. Is that?
That's a full year.
That's a full year.
And with your full year on the budget, we'll show you the year-to-date actual so that we can do the percentage.
The 491 has nothing to do with this, that these numbers, correct?
No. Yeah. Well, some
so that was just a part of the 491.
The 240 there is a part of the 491.
Yes, but these these numbers don't add up to 491.
No, correct.
Which is another way roughly of saying that about half of the staff projects are funded in some way or touched in some way by MCL.
Yeah.
Yeah, because there's like two variables here.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, you've got all the projects that are touched by Move Seattle, and then you've got all the funds, and then you've got,
So I have a question. Is there a way to add a third column where you have sort of to get the bigger picture around, okay, how are we leveraging other sources? But also, what is the levy percentage of these
that.
Expenditures, because then I think the life of the levy makes a little more sense, because it's like, well, life of the levy, but then these are more than just levy funds, right?
Yep.
So if that's possible, I don't know if that's, if you can break it down.
Yeah, we can.
And just be more numbers, you had a couple rows for each category showing the match money, the levy money, and the total money.
We can absolutely do that for you. I think what we didn't want to do is, we know we're trying to present and paint a clear picture, although we're not doing a good job here, but not overwhelm you with a lot of these different colors of money. But we can absolutely do that and show it to you so that is more different.
Yeah, and I think what, you know, we'll bring some new way of, you know, the next meeting where we review our financials, we will bring some new ways of showing it to and see what you guys think, because this is all going to influence how we report on it to our in our annual report, and I would like it to have your feedback and sort of your eyes to say this makes sense, this doesn't make sense. So,
and that really, I think that's the way to start is, I think the powerful message is that because of the voter support of the Move Seattle levy, the levy Move Seattle, we're able to do so much more. It is really the seed money or the foundation money that is allowing all of these projects to, you know, you approve this, but we're actually leveraging it to do that.
Yeah, right.
So maybe I think you start there on your big bold message, and then get into the kind of the weeds of how different colors of money come together to actually pencil it all out.
You know, the 95 is mushrooming into 240.
Exactly.
You know, on the last previous slide, you are 95 from North Seattle.
Brian, you're just trying to clarify that it's not, because a lot of Move Seattle was talking about matching funds, like from the Washdaughter federal government. This isn't matching funds. You're just trying to clarify that it's not really mushrooming or bringing in new money.
Yeah.
It's just that it's helping
packaged it
SDOT's own money go further. It's helping. Is that what you wanted to clarify?
Yeah. Well, are there federal grant programs in these dollars?
Yes.
It's blurrier than that. In fact, there are local match requirements to get some of these grants, and the 95 is helping us secure those grants. So I'm not saying it's not all of that, but it's...
We're going to do more than we could have had the voters not sent yes.
Yeah.
So somehow tell that story.
Great. Okay. So moving on, I do want to cover what we accomplished, but I wanted to throw some pictures in here and give our crews and our contract workers some credit. Some of the safe routes projects we've done, the Rainier Ave safety improvements, the Mercer Middle School new path there connecting some greenways and making it easier for kids to walk to school, and many curb ramps and crossing improvements so far in just the first 6 months. So on your spreadsheet, this is going to be a little hard to read on the screen. Did everyone got one? Okay, so these are the Levy to Move Seattle Safe Routes accomplishments. So these are a selection, not a complete entire list of all the work that SDOT does, but many of the accomplishments that we're tracking for Move Seattle Safe Routes. So if you go down the list, you'll see our work plan targets for the year, and then you'll also see what we've accomplished through quarter one and quarter two. You'll notice that some of the work, for example, sign replacement, sign repair, that can be done all times of the year, so those counts have been going. Other counts, for example, the neighborhood greenways were projected to install those later in Q4, so it shows zero for those where we stand right now. But it's listed still on track because the expected completion is later in the year. So just going down the list, I can walk through them all, or you can ask if you have questions, or Elizabeth.
You're saying the green means it's on track, but I thought we were fairly clear, sadly, the meeting I just did, that there won't be protected bike lanes installed this year. Certainly not 7.5 miles, but I'm not aware of that.
Those are from the division. I could check back with them, but they are expected in later in the year. I could get you a status update.
That's amazing.
Yeah, I mean it's early in the year. You know, expected.
Just because of one center city, we have heard like that it was on hold.
Well, these include Roosevelt. So these include Meridian. I'm trying to think of several of them.
Westlake?
What's that?
Westlake? Westlake?
Yep. Yep. So that's where those numbers are coming from. That doesn't get you to 7.5. I can get you the how it comes.
Is Westlake funded with Moose Seattle Levy, or is that Virginia County?
It was Moose Seattle at the end to finish the funding source.
So it looks like, so you started with three big buckets of money. So one bucket per page.
Yep.
And then each bucket is divvied up into its smaller buckets.
Yep, exactly. Yep, so at the top is our subcategory level. So all of those fund sources are helping get our Move Seattle accomplishments in the Safe Routes category.
So Elliot, just to clarify, the work plan target, that is for the calendar year 2016.
Yep.
So if all goes well, we'll have 7.5 new miles of protected bike lanes installed by December 31. That's the goal.
Okay. And these are work plan targets too. So what I would encourage all of you to, you know, sort of ask questions about and also understand with, these are susceptible to changes as well. So these are what we ask our different divisions, our different division directors and people working on these. Each year we say, what are you expecting? Sometimes things come up, but really the big picture that I want you guys to all be watching for is our commitment to delivering these accomplishments over the 9 years as well. Some things will change, some things will move, but what's important is that you guys are there sort of asking questions if they do move.
So just to clarify, Elliot, and I apologize if I missed this, did ESRA present this work plan target at the previous meeting?
No.
Okay. So this is moved.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Could you talk about in the future when we do have sort of, whether it's this coming year or after that, if we'll see any of that conversation before they're set, will we see potential targets as they're being developed and, you know, have any chance to either weigh in or just comment or anything?
Yeah. I think I'd have to look at sort of timing of when our meetings is and when they're going to set them.
Right.
But yeah, I think, you know, I can definitely try and
I can't remember quite how that worked, but typically we just see them kind of like after they're set.
Yeah.
So you're saying we should have some input before?
Oh, I don't know. You know, I don't know, but it's about input, it's to some degree prescribed by the levy, of course.
Yep. Yep.
But
the work plans generally have a lot of flexibility within the different divisions too.
Yeah.
You know, the work plans reflect what they're planning to do, their own internal targets. They of course know what their 9-year target goals are, but the levy is fairly flexible with annual goals. So.
When will the? Right now, everybody's meeting their target.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So when will kind of the reality of some people ahead of their targets, some people are at their targets, some people are on it? Yeah, in September?
Yeah, I would say if you're looking at some of those accomplishments that really have a lot of their work done in the summer, the question would be sort of the next quarter three, how much they got done, whether the summer weather cooperated, whether they, you know, got off schedule with rain delays or what have you. But with a lot of our work, you know, like I mentioned, 2/3 of our budget is spent in the last half of the year. That also means a lot of our accomplishments are coming. That's fairly susceptible to changes in weather and sort of other things that come up. So, you know, they're all on track right now, like you said, but quarter three might look a little different.
So maybe it'd be good to see this again in September or October.
Yeah, we're going to review this quarterly. Yeah.
Is most of the work gets farmed out? I mean, is it contracted out or part of it gets done by the?
It really depends. So a lot of our operations and maintenance work, so our paving spot repairs, the smaller paving projects, sidewalk repair, sign replacing signs, things like that, that are sort of bread and butter SDOT jobs, those are done by our crews. You look at our larger projects, paving, bigger paving projects like Roosevelt or Meridian or protected bike lanes, things like that are largely done by contract work. There are limits, you know, to amounts in that SDOT can spend, so.
Can you talk about, you said that this is not a comprehensive list, this is only a kind of a sample. Can you talk about what's not on the list? Is it smaller projects? Is it, I mean,
yeah, so
what sort of makes the cut here?
What we did, how we got this list is we took out sort of what the levy legislation required, and then we talked to different divisions about sort of highlight metrics, like the levy doesn't specifically require, for example, the amount of in-lane bike lanes that were building, but we thought people would want to know what those are, so we added them in. My plan is actually to go back to all of these different divisions at the end of the year, ask them what we're not counting, but that they are doing with levy money, and see if there are any things they either want to have, or potentially if there's something that, and this is up to you guys too, if there's something that you think, who cares about that, you know, or something we can, we don't have to count it as well. I would like to sort of stay big picture, you know, when looking at sort of what moves Seattle, the levy moves Seattle committed to, knowing that these are helpful for some people, but trying to stay big picture when we think about it.
Yeah, I think it's important for us to remember our primary job is oversight of that levy money.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So, you know, I just want to make sure that if things are left off, that somehow we were able to capture that. So.
Yeah, yeah, and that, like, yeah, you're capturing sort of that right now in the finance part of it, but yeah. Yep,
so recognizing that the committee itself is still ramping up, do you anticipate as part of the practice of this committee of sending this ahead of time for the relevant meeting that, because it's hard, I mean, it's great to get it,
yep.
But I would just appreciate having more of a few minutes or while we're talking to sort of process the
process.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. It's really hard for me to look at it. 4 million questions when I get here and haven't seen it. So at least a couple, 3 days ahead.
Okay.
Yeah, if we can get to the library a week ahead of time, that'd be great.
Yeah. So then we can come prepared.
Questions.
Okay.
Great.
Just from a standpoint of format, I think, I don't know about other people, but I prefer more in a PowerPoint flip
okay.
document that just look at on our computers.
Okay.
You mean when it's sent to us?
Yeah. All right, so moving on to maintenance and repair, a couple projects from our, or a couple pictures from some of our recent projects. And then we've got our maintenance and repair accomplishments, so what we've done so far and what our targets are for the year. If anyone has any questions about roads, the difference between roads paved and lane miles of paving, I wanted to keep separate. The roads paved refers to our larger paving projects. It's our AAC program, and those are the Meridians, the Roosevelts, the big paving projects. Lane miles of paving refers to our spot, how many different spot repairs we're doing. So those can be a block in length, they can be a half a block in length, but what does that add up to? Lane mile equivalent.
So they're completely exclusive.
Yep. Yep. Different funding source. Yeah. Any questions about those?
So since I'm interested in trees.
Yep.
Even though this may be getting too specific, do you remember the number that the levy mentioned as far as tree planting?
2 to 1. Oh, it didn't mention a total number, sorry. It mentioned a ratio of 2 trees planted for every 1 removed. That was the... Sorry.
On public property.
On our SDOT right away, yeah. Right. Yep.
So I'm just curious what a 300 gets in there near that, you know, with the...
Yep. Yep. We are tracking trees removed, actually. It's nothing that we're really sort of highlighting because it's not a number that we actually... you don't want to remove trees, so it's nothing we put on here. I could certainly get you that number if you're kind of curious, but we're ending up planting a lot more than we're removing, but I can get you the actual number.
Good.
Yeah. And the planting happens in the fall, largely.
Well, that makes sense.
Yeah. Any other questions about maintenance and repair category?
So are these work plan targets proportional throughout the last year annually, or is this?
This will be reflected differently annually. I don't know what their targets are going to be for 2017. Some may be similar if the funding is equivalent, and that's somewhat, you know, if that's just the amount of work there is, that might be the amount of work there is, and that's going to be the same. But many of them are also going to ramp up.
It just seems like road paving.
Yeah, those will ramp up. You know, the levy committed to 180, so that 20 there on the paving for the AAC program is actually kind of smack, you know, 1/9 of it. I don't expect it to always be that way. Some will be less, some will be more. But yeah.
So what would be useful, Elliot, is, and I don't think we need to do that for each section, but kind of an overview of what the big picture 9-year goals were, so there's some frame of reference, recognizing that it'll move, it'll change, right, as priorities shift, but just kind of to have that, what is the goal post that we're working towards? Yeah. And yeah, it'll look very small for year one, but hopefully by the time we get to year 8 and 9, it's a good goal.
All right, then moving on to our last one, congestion relief. Several different accomplishments that we're tracking there. In this action category, we've met several of the accomplishments that we've already set for the year. So that work is phased in the first half, and we've accomplished it. Any questions or comments here?
That's ITS.
Intelligent Transportation Systems. So what that really means is it's our miles of connection that we've added to our transportation operations center. So we have a room down on one of our SF floors, two floors below here, where we actually track and monitor traffic throughout the city and how many miles we're adding to our coverage of the network. So,
are there some overlaps between, so some of the new sidewalks built are also part of the Safe Routes to School walking and biking routes?
So there's no overlap in counting. The new sidewalks could potentially be a new Safe Route to School, but that new Safe Route to School accomplishment is only counting which school that Safe Route has been created at.
It's not counting miles, it's counting number of schools.
Yep.
Where this is the actual, yeah. I see.
And so that's a good question, Elizabeth, because one thing the levy did do that was different than bridging the gap is we have some things like safety corridors and things like that. So we're counting both the safety corridor projects that were committed to in the levy, and then also all the different accomplishments that go along with it. Similar to our big paving projects as well. Each major paving project in our AAC program comes with a lot of curb ramps, a lot of sidewalk repair, a lot of all of that, and we're making sure we're counting all of that too as those projects progress and adding to the total. Which, when they're contract work, it's a little bit, if our crews are doing it, it's entered into the system right away and that those are accomplished. We get those pretty quickly. If it's contract work, we're reliant on the contractors giving us their work orders and entering them in there. So
for some of the transit corridor improvements and the major BRT type, are those reflected under accomplishments later but not this year, or how is that reflected?
So the larger corridors?
Well, or, like the BRT.
Yeah, so those,
how is that not reflected?
Those are not reflected here. They would be reflected going forward. We'll start counting them once they start construction, but because they're all still in design, we're not counting them during the year one of the study. All right. Seeing no further questions, I'm actually going to pivot over to my colleague, Kristen Simpson, to talk about the leveraging strategy with the audience.
Yeah. Thank you, Elliot. I just have two slides, so this will be a bit of an introduction, and then I would like to come back to you regularly and update you on where we are with the leveraging. Just to give you a sense of what I'm even talking about when I say leveraging, you might remember that the levy is $930 million. Delivering all the work that we've committed to as part of the levy assumes $285 million in local non-levy funding and $564 million in
leverage, and by leverage we mean state grants, federal grants, partnerships with other agencies, potential private contributions, anything that's not either levy or local city funding. And then this shows how that flows into the three different categories in the levy. So really what jumps out on this is how much the congestion relief category relies on leveraging, and that's primarily those transit corridor projects that have some hefty federal assumptions for the BRT corridors, for example. You can click, it'll show where we are. Yes, so this is showing the percentage of that leveraging money that we have in hand to date, not literally cash in hand, but secured. If you go to the next slide, it just shows that in a little more detail. So we're at about 20% of our goal so far. I want to stress that this was not a typical year. A lot of our grants are on a two-year cycle, and so you'll see an up year and then a down year. This also includes some funding that was secured for levy-funded projects prior to this year, but is going directly into those levy projects. So we're doing great, but don't expect us to do this every year. But it does show some good progress towards those goals already, so I
So the dark green is where we are here to date?
Yes. So we've got 21% of the congestion relief, 16 of the maintenance and repair, and 10 of the safe routes.
And that's for the overall program
that's
life?
For 9 years. Yeah, for 9 years. So I'll be updating this on a regular basis for you. If there are no questions at this point, I will turn it back over.
So, Kristen, would you say then that you're on track because you've had 2 years out of 9 and we got 19%? So it's sort of there?
It's really hard to say what will happen in the future. We got a couple pretty sizable infusions for Lander, and we don't know if those opportunities will be available on a regular basis for that size of grant and that size of project.
How do we differentiate between when there's a maybe at the end and who's got to start in terms of some of those grants? Are you specifically tied to one level?
No, the grants are specifically tied to a project. For example, Lander's a good example. Any money we've obtained for Lander, we are counting here, whether it was before the levy passed or after.
So some of this actually reflects bridging the gap?
It's not bridging the gap money.
But it's a project that may have originated under bridging the gap?
Or maybe matched by bridging the gap? Bridging the gap create the match that made the grant possible?
Well, I don't think Lander was going anywhere unless the levy passed. Some of the paving projects, the design maybe started under bridging the gap.
So we have a sort of a clean break between leverage and bridging the gap.
Do we or?
Yeah,
we'll show that. I can go back through each one of the projects and see how much of bridging the gap leverage the start of that project.
I was just curious if what's actually reflected in these percentages. Solely moves, leverage that occurred because of moves, but there was some of the carryover. Right.
I would say it's leverage that we would not be able to use it without the levy, the current levy.
Can you show the first slide again?
Yeah.
So there's 150 million leverage. And you said that does include federal and state matching in this year's budget, right? From 90 to 240
ish. That includes local and.
And this right. Includes local too. So the total for the whole leverage over the life, 5, 6, 7, 8.5. And there's already 150 in the first year. Is that?
The total over the life is 564 plus 285.
I thought I just did that. 850? Is that added together, 850-ish?
Yeah.
So, and then there's 150 this year out of 850, which seems like more than one-ninth. So just doing the math real quickly in my head, I was trying to follow it. Is that, like, because we're getting more leverage, or it's what you said, there was just a really good year this year, and then it'll be a lot less next year, and it should still be about 850 million leverage? It's too complicated a question.
Where's the 150 year?
The next one.
So, trying to go back to this original document you had, wasn't it like instead of 95 it was
240.
Yeah.
It's going to be a little bit easier, I think, if you think about the local and the leverage separately, but I see you're adding them together to say we've got Move Seattle and then we've got our local leverage together, and that's 150, which is more than one-ninth of what we need to get throughout the levy, right? Yeah. And the thing that's, there's two things that are going to drive that. Our local is not going to be exactly the same every year of the levy, because we're going to potentially build up a balance of local funds so that we can use it for a large project. So it's going to, it may be fairly flat, but it has the potential to change as our need changes. We submit, we do a process every year where we do a six-year cash flow, and so things change as projects change. And then on the leverage side of things, it sounds like we have had a wonderful year, but it is a two-year cycle, and there's not always necessarily going to be the same opportunities. So we feel good, but have to keep all fingers crossed on that side. Does that help?
Yep.
These slides are going to be available, right? On
I'm actually, I'll put these up on our oversight committee webpage on the website.
Can you go back a slide? I just want to note, it seems like the congestion relief deliverables, to me, like I look at this and I see a lot of risk in that bucket because there's just so much leverage there. And I would just like to hear you all, finance folks at SDOT, talk about your own assessment of that, because it just looks like here there's so much contingency there that if, you know, the lander sort of freight award that happened is great, but if it didn't happen, what would be the risk with lander, right? And I just imagine over the next 8.5 years there are a lot of projects that might face that same sort of point where, you know, year five we're looking at this and the congestion relief, there's a lot of rents. So I'm just trying to get a sense of perspective from SDOT on the various categories, because the other ones look maintenance repair, that looks good, safe routes looks pretty good, congestion relief just looks to be.
Yes, it's heavily leveraged.
Yeah. And I think that's actually sort of one of the great points of this slide, is that it really does show the importance of leverage to getting our long-term levy accomplishments delivered. It's all, you know, there's a plan to get there and there's a strategy to get there, but I think getting that point across is sort of what the intention was here too, is that bridging the gap was fairly similar, you know, in the safe routes and the maintenance and repair categories. What makes the levy to Move Seattle really so transformative and unique is that what we're delivering for our congestion relief bucket. But that does require some leverage. And then it's a point we kind of wanted to bring up and make sure we bring it up with you and make that point clear from the beginning.
Yeah. Well, there's some risk. There's also the fact that they're a bit of the way they're one year in.
I think it's good to stay flat and have the projects to capitalize on the opportunities, but to also flip side of that, note that a bad year in the grant cycle might jeopardize certain projects.
Yeah.
I'm just curious, kind of this understanding, it sounds like we always use this transit corridors were the most leveraged. Is that kind of consistent in terms of percentage of leverage across, or are some more than others because the capital investment? So I'm thinking Madison BRT, right, where it's much more capital intensive than, say, I'm thinking. Any of the others. And so I'm just curious, kind of, if within those categories, are there certain kind of certain projects that SDOT feels have better in terms of being able to secure those match, you know, those federal dollars, and that would be helpful to kind of understand that a little bit. I know some of us did it because we were in the campaign,
right,
I feel in general, it's just hard to kind of figure out.
Yeah, and this, these assumptions were built up based on an assessment of what opportunities might be available. It sounds like what might be of interest to the group is if I come back with a little bit more detail on the congestion relief category specifically and what the assumptions are behind that and what some of the most leveraged projects are, just so you have a better understanding of what goes into that large bucket. I'd be happy to do that.
Great. Well, we're getting a little behind, so I want to move us on to my colleague Megan Hoyt, who's here to talk about the Neighborhood Street Fund. She's going to go over the overview, talk about the program, and then we're going to briefly talk about how we are actually going to make the selections later this year. From there.
Hi, everybody. So I am excited to finally meet you all because I've been talking about you for a long time. Like, and later, here's what happens. The Oversight Committee picks the project. So what we're going to talk about today is, I'm just going to give a really fast overview of what the Neighborhood Street Fund is, the kind of projects that are in it, and just how it's overall structured. We'll go over how what's already happened in the selection process, and then the part that you would play a role in, what that schedule looks like. We did create some draft evaluation criteria, which we'll share at that time. And then a big question, I have questions for you, and then you can have questions for me too. And some of my questions will be, how can we SDOT then support you in your selection process? What are the kind of materials and information you'll need to be able to make a decision? So first, the Neighborhood Street Fund, it's been around for a while. So it's already run three entire cycles. And it is a three-year cycle, so it only comes up once every 3 years, unlike some of the grant programs that come up annually. So just every 3 years. It's fully funded by the levy, no other money in there. I know after the big money we've been talking about here, $8 million is kind of a small sum, but it's you can do an awful lot with $8 million directly into neighborhoods. And the key thing about this program is these are not SDOT-driven projects. These were all community-driven. People applied for these projects. They created the idea and put forward applications. The range is basically starting at $100,000. We have different grant funds that usually get capped at about $90,000. And so our key on this one is, well, that's for the smaller projects. And once you get up to the $100,000 range to design and construct, it's going to probably move to something like the Neighborhood Street Fund and cap it approximately at $1 million. That's not a hard deadline, but with only, you know, up to $8 million in a particular funding cycle, there's not too many projects you can fund if they're all $1 million. And I'll run through a lot of the things that it can fund, but it's, you see a lot of the bigger capital projects. So sidewalks, lighting, you know, just real big ticket items that you can't necessarily fund through smaller grant funds. The way this process works, this is the selection year. And then once projects are selected, they get designed in 2017 and prepared for construction in 2018. And they range all over the city. We gave some guidelines for what a successful project is, some limitations. A key one, it had to be within SDOT right-of-way. So we, even though we get along well with parks, we weren't going to try for something that wasn't, you know, that is on parks property or is on Washington State Department of Transportation property or on private property. So we actually hit some of that in some of these projects, and there's one that actually didn't fully meet this that's in here. Environmental process, we say, fits within this timeline. If we know that there's an environmental something happening with the process that is going to take 5 years and involve the Coast Guard, it's not really a good fit for the Neighborhood Street Fund because we're working on this three-year cycle. And then the key one, and this is what we're figuring out during conceptual design, is it has to actually be something SDOT can build. So even though we can say, oh, that's a great idea, it still has to meet warrants, the right numbers, especially for something like a traffic signal, hallway stops, even mark crosswalks. They still need to be, we can't build something that SDOT wouldn't otherwise build. Some of our past projects, it has been something like this on 30th Avenue Southwest that had no sidewalk whatsoever. And this is a full build out curb gutter sidewalk. So this is sort of like our Cadillac version of sidewalk. I would say this year, it, more so now than in other years, we've been talking about more low-cost sidewalks. So especially if someone asks for a really long stretch of sidewalk, we might be looking at something less than the full concrete build-out, just so it can actually fit under $1 million. This here at Maynard was building a curb bulb at the corner and also extending the sidewalk out as you go up the street in order to fit in trees, so sort of adding a small planting strip in the International District. Fairview Avenue, I got to work on that one, actually, as the project engineer. It went along Lake Union, and it really was just improving the pedestrian path, but the key thing that this one got is the lights. So this was an expensive project because it got lighting in through this whole corridor to make it better for nighttime commuting. So lights come up a lot, Neighborhood Street Fund. And the Georgetown Festival Street was one that just recently happened. And Festival Streets, you'll see it a lot in the applications that came up this year. So, and when we say Festival Street, a Festival Street is a very particular thing. Some people more describe, more just wanting their street to be festive, which is a slightly different thing. So we're kind of calling it all Festival Street in a very broad sense of more activation. And here you see up high where there was a raised crosswalk. We got a lot of requests for raised crosswalks this year. A lot of them ended up not being feasible, but that's absolutely something that can be constructed as part of this program. And you can go anything from stairs, art, just basic curb bulbs, again, more curbless streets. So it's a wide range of capital projects. So the actual selection process, it started in a call for applications that I believe was back in February, March. Applications came in mid-April, and then the Neighborhood District Councils actually had a really large role in this. There were over 140 applications submitted, and each of the 13 district councils got to pick 5 projects to move forward. So at the district council level is where the initial vetting happened. We just administered the process. So the district councils picked those, and there's 13 of them. They picked 5 projects. So we have 65 projects right now that are in this June through August conceptual design process. And that's when we take it, and some of the ideas were very specific, some of the ideas were very vague. And so we've run with both of those to try to create something that's actually, again, something we build, something that's not $3 million, and trying to work through that. We are hoping to finish that next month. And then in September, we kind of figured this is actually more concurrently because you'll see them at the same time they do. We have decided, even with the recent executive order from the mayor, since we're in the middle of this process, we're still planning on sending all the projects back to the respective district councils. They had a role and they'll still have it. They get to rank the projects. So they picked 5. They might not like some of the things we did to their projects. That might not exactly be what they wanted. So they get a chance to say, all right, we're going to rank them. This actually is our favorite now, and this is not our favorite. That's not a binding thing, but that was originally part of our process, and so that's information we'll get. And then here's the part where you come in, actually reviewing all 65 applications and projects and making a recommendation on what should get funded. So it's actually a pretty enormous role. That's what I mean. I have been hyping you for quite some time saying, nope, SDOT's not picking. Like, we can have our own opinion about these projects, but in the end, we're not actually going to pick it to. And then we're hoping that happens at the October meeting so that in November we can actually put this list forward for officializing in the budget.
And then that list is fully funded.
That list would be fully funded. Assuming that we tell you make all the numbers add up to this number, then that will be fully funded, yep.
And our job is, when you say we pick it, we recommend it into the budget and then the budget's adopted by council, right? So
I'll be honest, that's actually a question I still have. I'm a little unclear how that all works. Since this is levy money, it doesn't need to, and all the finance people left, so I'm not sure.
Okay.
I don't know how official that final process needs to be, and I'm not sure too much changing would happen after you selected something, frankly.
How does the change in district councils or the proposed changes impact? I mean, obviously it doesn't for this cycle, but future cycles.
It will probably change it quite a lot, and we'll be working through that before the next 3-year cycle. So the schedule that we worked with Elliot to propose, a schedule for what this would look like, we expect to have all of those conceptual design sheets, I'm going to say the middle to the end of August, that they'd be available. And a lot of this is because there is history, so I know you have folks who come before you with the Bridging the Gap Oversight Committee. Actually went out and saw the projects. In that particular case, they divided into three sectors, like the North Sector, Central, and the South. And the members who went to a certain district did not live in that district. So if you were really familiar with like the South, and it was like, well, you have to pick the Central or the North, went out to see the project locations. Evaluate them. I'm going to talk next about the evaluation criteria we're suggesting, and then actually try to select the projects at the October 20th meeting that you have. The evaluation criteria, and we were a little bit pushed to do this because you didn't exist yet at the time that district councils wanted to know how they should think about the projects. So we really realized that with the levy having passed, having some sort of evaluation criteria that was based on the key things, that slide that Elliot skipped. You know, that talks about safety, an interconnected city, a vibrant city, affordable city. We suggest that as a way to think about that. And I will hand out, we came up with some ideas of how you could think about that. We could say district priority. You know, that's something you can absolutely consider. I mean, that may be very helpful information to see, well, this went to the district councils and boy, they really didn't like this project as much as another one. And then for equity considerations, we're going to provide information both on where projects had happened in the past, as well as like the racial the characteristics of that district. So we have some really good maps about kind of like what are the demographics of Seattle. And we can run it by a lot of things. I mean, we definitely recommend running it by race. We can also run it by income. So in terms of equity, this is why I have questions about what kind of information we want to give you. But we suggest that that be considered as well. So the information we're going to give, we're taking the idea that people had and we're turning it into something that's somewhat formal. Here's what the applicant said was the problem. Here's what the applicant proposed. Then you can flip over the page and you say, okay, here's what Estes actually came up with based on all of that information. It's going to have a cost estimate. You know, this one is over $600,000. The cost estimates that are going to be on here are design and construction. And so what you're not going to see, unless you need to see it, is that kind of the sausage making behind that. So what we find is that it sounds somewhat shocking how much it costs to build a project sometimes. You know, a block of sidewalk, we say it usually costs about $350,000 per block face to build it. And a large proportion of that is not the actual contractor going out and building the sidewalk. It's the fact that we have to get survey and we do a really good outreach and engagement process. And then we have a contractor and then we have someone watching over the contractor. So like all those soft costs do add up. So what you're seeing here is the actual cost to build. And then in that sense, you know, fully funded. We had to be a little more conservative this time because during the last process, I think every project ended up going over budget. They unfortunately were saved by one project actually had to stop. It couldn't go forward. So one project had to drop out, and so the budget was saved. But we're trying to avoid that. We want everything that gets funded to go forward. The graphic's also going to talk, there'll be a graphic that shows what we're proposing. And then it'll also talk about impacts and benefits. So some of the impacts you might find, like on the sidewalk, are, turns out everyone's front yards were in the right of way and they may not have known it. So if we build the sidewalk, everyone's front yards are gonna get trimmed back onto the right of way line. It could be changing traffic circulation, you know, adding a signal. So we're gonna try to call those out. And there's a few that are maybe a little risky. I'll give a spoiler. There is a roundabout in here. One of the cautions we'll put there is like, well, SDOT certainly supports this, but boy, we've never built a roundabout. So there's some risk inherent in that just because we're not the pros. And then the other thing we want to provide is probably in an Excel format, but again, tell us what it would look like best of supporting information. And why don't I hand out our evaluation criteria? Because some of the things that we talk about what a safe city is, chances are you want to know a little about if there have been collisions at the intersection, for instance. And you know, I look at that and it'd be a multi-page piece of paper with all the collision diagrams in it. Is that something that's helpful? Should we just say, yes, there have been collisions? So we do have some questions about that.
Why don't you talk about that now?
You're using the core values as the evaluation criteria.
That's what we're suggesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you focus on from the city strategic plan?
These are reflective of the Move Seattle strategic vision. Yeah. So they, the city uses them, we use them, but they're really baked into sort of our SDOT strategic planning.
Yeah, it does bring up larger question, because I think the what ended up in the Move Seattle legislation was just slightly different from those the larger core values. It would be helpful at a future meeting to understand how those crosswalk. So there are five values for the strategic plan, but then the Move Seattle had three specific buckets around congestion relief, safe routes, and the maintenance, I guess, was the third one. And so how are they, I'm assuming they are, but sort of what does that crosswalk look like in terms of, does that make sense? Because you have a whole bunch, because you have a whole bunch of performance measures, right, that SDOT has that are focused on the larger sort of five values and how your meeting goes with quantitative and qualitative, but then, you know, the council condensed it into three buckets, and so what does that actually look like? In terms of measurement, I think, and evaluation.
I mean, I echo that because, frankly, I'm just a little concerned about how we translate vibrancy, affordability, innovation. If you look at the buckets, what's the crosswalk there? For me, that's a big concern. And I think looking forward to reporting, I think I'd like to see some dialogue on where we are with integrating those two things.
Yeah, and I think that's why, and it's kind of, go over to Betty for this one, whereas I think I'm hoping that many of you would like to participate in sort of looking at these projects, looking at where they would be built, because I think you might have a better sense too of how it would fit into that vibrancy, innovative, interconnectedness by seeing it and by knowing what kind of impact it's going to have on that neighborhood that's requested.
I think, since you mentioned the last time we did this, and I did have an opportunity to do this a couple times, and it's a real challenge. It's really meaningful work. I think across the board, the Bridging the Gap Committee folks said this is one of the most meaningful things we did. And we did go to neighborhoods we didn't know, we weren't familiar with, that was intended, so we didn't pick our neighborhood favorite product. So you have to go someplace you didn't know. And then here's what we found, is every single project should be done. You know, every single one is great. So then you have to think, well, how are you going to really actually rank these and evaluate them and ultimately pick one? And it was really hard. So, you know, having some conversation around how you make that choice is a good idea. And then you go out there and you're faced with the reality of having to pick A or B when they're both great. One of the things we talked a lot about was, you know, sort of which ones deliver the most bang for the buck. These are all expensive projects. You only have a limited amount of money. So how do you figure out in some way whether project A at X number of dollars is really going to make the community, is meeting the needs of the community? I don't know. I can't remember much more than we did, but I will just guarantee you that for those of you who do this, it'll be a really good experience and a really hard experience. And the extent to which we can talk about how you make that choice collectively, how we're kind of consistent, and it is a good idea.
So did you, the whole group, went to a particular area?
No, the way we did this was, it was north, central, and south. And so you picked it, you know, the opposite of where you lived or whatever. I live in the north end, so I went to the south end. And we just split up the projects. So I actually went out with my husband one day, and because he knew the streets better than I did in the part of town that we were in. And so we just drove around, and I had a little piece of paper, and we had some ranking, and I wrote down my notes. And we didn't go as groups or anything like that. I suppose you could, but.
How do you build a consensus? You know, how did you?
I think it was different last time. We didn't make the ultimate decision, I don't think, or maybe we recommended.
You did.
We did, and maybe we recommended.
Yeah, sort of what we were proposing is taking a show of hands, seeing who's interested in going out and looking at them within the group here, then splitting you up based on where you live, letting you guys either choose if you want to do it in a group or individually like you did, and then coming back here to a separate meeting that's not at this time, sort of hashing out what you guys saw when you went to South and Central, when you went to North, and then presenting that group, presenting to the full group, assuming not everyone's in it, at that October meeting, your recommendations, and that this larger group would largely be agreeable to what the people who went out and looked at the projects are suggesting. And I think getting to some criteria that you guys can all agree on is essential, and I would push for that at our next meeting. So take some time, go home, look at this sheet, kind of think about what these values mean to you, how you look at a project. Because I do want that to come from you guys. We were talking about it, we were saying we could suggest some things, but being as it's the Oversight Committee selecting them and these are neighborhood-driven projects, we didn't want to say you're going to rank it this way, this way, and this way.
Do you have the criteria we used last time?
Yeah.
So, but that you didn't, that's not what you gave us.
We have the spreadsheets that we can give you at the next meeting.
Like a blank one to show us how we did it last time.
Yeah, why not?
I just have a few questions. First of all, you keep saying our next meeting. Isn't our next meeting when we're choosing this? If we meet quarterly, when we meet
quarterly? There's an August meeting as well.
August meeting. It's still in August. We have one more meeting to go in August.
I'm not.
Yeah, we're meeting monthly for the next.
Oh, we are meeting monthly? Sorry.
Great.
That's good.
Yeah,
I definitely want to make sure that income is looked at in equity. I know you said that, but like, yes, please. And then, I'm sorry, I'm sure you said this and I missed it, but how much is the total fund and how many-ish projects get funded? Do I know that it depends on if we can create expensive or...
That's a great question. We say up to $8 million. In reality, this selection process has to come out of that $8 million, and really so does part of the next one because this one started a little late. So if you say that leaves probably about $7 million, I need to work with the actual program owner to come up with the number, but we're thinking, especially because they had so many cost overruns last time, that when we're actually in the design process, we want to leave a little. We're probably thinking to make the numbers add up to about $6.5 million.
And there were 65 applicants, is that what you said?
There's 65 applications now. They got winnowed down from 140 to about 65, and they are really going to vary in cost. There's some that are, I'd say the lower end is probably close to 300,000. There are definitely some that are way over $1 million. You know, given what was asked for. And then there's a lot right in that $600,000 to $900,000 range. I think in past years, usually about 12 projects were selected, but now there's more money than there was during Bridging the Gap. So that's that approach is 100% up to you.
And that's sort of, a decision for all of you is, do we do more bigger projects or do we do, or fewer bigger projects or, more smaller ones, so. Yeah.
How much community involvement was there around each project? Because I have a project in my neighborhood and I always look at it and go, what? So I'm curious.
Yes, this was a very good discussion that we had with a lot of the district councils and certainly internally. We did no community engagement about the projects that were proposed, and it wasn't required as part of the application. And then once they're funded, once there's an actual funded process, then we start the engagement immediately. And on some of them, you'll notice in the narrative, that is some of the risk. Boy, this would really change circulation, and we'd have to work really closely with your neighborhood.
So it's not until it's funded that you go out and talk to people?
Yeah.
Seems like that should be a criteria. The extent to which a project down the street is completely support or it doesn't have these risks associated with potential.
So here's what the balance was, and it's a great question, and actually I'd love your feedback as we shape up the program for the future, because it was trying to have a low bar for people to apply. So a lot of people say with other grant programs, boy, there's a lot of hoops to jump through. So we really had a conversation of, if we want everyone to be able to just say, here's this thing in the neighborhood I don't want, do we really expect them to organize, go out, and talk to all the neighbors? So that's where we were left with deciding that, no, we're not going to require that this year. So it certainly changes up the program, and it really changes up the application process. Because then we have to say, well, what does that even look like? So they go talk to them, and how do they even demonstrate support? So I'd love to have this conversation, because we certainly had it a lot in trying to, and I'm not saying we did the right thing, But we couldn't even decide how to show, and we find this when we do our projects. We're like, well, we can hear all the complaints, and we can even sometimes guess where they're going to come from, and then they do, and we say, well, should we still do the project anyway? Like, doesn't this seem it's for the greater good? So I'm not sure how to measure it in the future. I know, it was really tricky.
So Megan, you're looking, or Elliot's suggesting a subcommittee of this group to look at the criteria to evaluate whether it's these 5 or 3 or 2 or some hybrid thereof. And then that subcommittee also be willing to go out and kick some tires?
Yes.
Okay.
And then come back and actually represent that to the group.
Yeah. And I would propose that we could actually as a group discuss the criteria at our next meeting, full group, and then the subcommittee would be the one going up.
Yeah.
So this is a sort of question, comment. Are we weighting these 5 particularly? And also, how does Section 7 of the levy that talks about evaluating projects based on Vision Zero, Safe Routes, and Racial and Social Justice Initiative, how does that overlay with this evaluation criteria?
For the
agreement,
the first one was, the
weighting.
We actually at one point did weight them. And then we said that's not really for us to weight. Like we had, that shouldn't be our opinions on how to weight this, so we were going to leave that with you, but what the criteria should be and how you want to weight them. And for the second, you asked how it intersected with a lot of them. Okay. And that ties into what information we should give you and what form. So when all the projects came in, the first thing we did was get out the bike master plan, the ped master plan, and that begs the question of the old ped master plan or the new pedestrian master plan that probably won't be adopted till December. The Vision Zero projects, Transit Master Plan, and Freight Master Plan, also proposed, not adopted projects. So we pulled all those together, and we do have a spreadsheet that lists each of the 65 projects and whether they aligned at all with that. So that actually is a very easy one to provide. The other thing you'll see, there's a cost estimate on the sample I gave. And this is the point where I'm actually kind of shopping around to the different programs to see if there's leverage from like Master Plan, Ped Master Plan, Vision Zero, and some of them are going to be leveraging. So for some of the projects, you'll say, oh, this is a $1 million project, and then SDOT matching funds, so to speak, SDOT leverage or SPU leverage is $200,000. So the NSF request is only $800,000. So you'll see that in there too. And that's mostly indicating something that basically Estes was like, yes, we really care about this. We're going to do this anyway at some point. It just isn't now. And we're also, there's a few in here that is going to have SPU money. We found some natural drainage partnerships on some of these projects.
So I'm going to, in an effort to keep us on track here, I'm going to ask for you guys, just a show of hands, I'll write it down, who's interested in being a part of this committee. You can say yes now, or you can, okay, perfect.
Should we raise by notes off? Is that
I have that. Yep. Perfect. And then we will.
Calvin here.
Well,
and
going out to
look at projects
is mostly September.
Yes. Yep. Okay. Because we'll need to wait until we get the full list from Megan.
I have a list.
So you do provide cost.
Yep.
When you give us the list.
Okay.
And public. I'm sorry. Public. What do we should we expect at our meeting? Do we anticipate that the 55 applicants may show up here? Will they testify? Will they want to testify?
No,
it's
not a public
hearing.
This is a public meeting.
Yeah, it's a public meeting. Betty, did people come in the past?
Very rarely.
Okay.
And I don't think. We had some issues around the process, but we didn't have any project yet.
And then, because I would hate, will we let them know, do they know when we're doing the projects, and they know when we meet? Because I would hate for someone after the fact to say, I didn't know they were screened and there was a public meeting that I didn't know about. I just think we should be thoughtful of that.
Yeah.
And then related to that, and I think we may have touched on this at our first meeting, and I apologize, I've forgotten. You know, this is a public body, our records are public. You know, if we're communicated directly by applicants, do we want to encourage folks, is there a general email?
Yes.
For Move Seattle at SDOT that encourage people to send their emails to, as opposed to showing up individually to us. I just want to think about how we handle this.
And we should probably, talk about that, because when I make this public, we're going to have all the information available on our website. Like, you'll be able to get all the PDFs on the website. Around that time, I'll email all the applicants at the same time saying, hey, here's your, now you get to see what we came up with as well. And so that's a great time to set the tone for how to do that. And I wasn't planning on saying, they certainly know that you're going to be picking the projects. That's been out there from the very beginning. I don't know if how many people put the pieces together that there would actually be a meeting at a particular time and place and look it up. So
you and Elliot think through that a little bit.
It's definitely going to be asked of us, so I think that people will know. Once we solidify that we will get the projects when we get them and we can do them in the timeline, and that, like, right now we have October 20th as sort of the target bullseye. Once that gets solidified and people ask, we will have, I don't have no problem telling them this is when it's going to happen. And then, we send out the agendas. People will know if they want to know about that.
If anyone approaches you, wants to know about NSF, it's really easy. It's just nsf@seattle.gov. And that's, so a few of us, you check that email.
And if it's General Move Seattle, you can send them my way.
Megan, I ran some really quick numbers, and unless I'm missing something, we're only going to be able, at the average cost of, say, $600,000 to $700,000, we'll be selecting about 1/6 for approval, and the other 5/6 will be cut.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So I'm thinking public input is great, but I mean, when we're rejecting so many, 15 people seems like almost more than enough, What am I trying to say? It would be pretty chaotic if we had 65 people showing up advocating for their project when we
have experience if people have not, and it's not like city council where they say, come talk. It's just like a monthly meeting, and while we all find it fascinating, it's not.
They tend to do more advocating and explaining other projects at the district council.
I was also an applicant. I submitted something I went through, by me doing that there, I mean, I understand that I didn't even think that we would be coming to any other meeting. I just thought, once you go to district council decides, and then from there it goes to SDOT, and SDOT will go from there. So I never thought about coming in here, all 65 of us coming in here, 140 people coming in here to talk about it again, because we knew the criteria at the beginning, and we know that SDOT still is going to have to go through. I mean, if they approve it, they would have to take it through the design stage. If you had what they wanted for the design stage, then you may be committed to going to the next stage.
That's a lot of responsibility on the 15 of us.
If you have questions about NSF, please feel free to reach out to me. The last thing I wanted to say is, at the last meeting, I put out a call for chairs or co-chairs. So we need a chair or co-chairs to lead this thing. And what I realized after many of you emailed me in is this was going to be a lot of email correspondence, and I want to keep this kind of official business to our actual meetings. And so what I'm going to propose tonight is all of you who have either emailed me and still interested in chairing or co-chairing, raising your hands, or if you want to still think about it, I'll give you 2 more weeks to email me. And then I'm going to send it out to the group in our next correspondence, and then if you're interested, presenting to the group very quickly about why you want to chair, co-chair, and then we'll go around and actually thank you. We'll do a simple majority vote. But many of you emailed me with an interest, some of you with a caveat. If no one else is interested, then I will do it. But a lot of you were interested. So,
quick process question. It occurs to me, I don't think last time we had terms. Is there a term? Is it going to be an annual chair, or is it going to be a chair until you're done?
What I got to thinking about as well is I wanted to have a chair or co-chair selected before we sort of got into our guideline principles. I would be more than, I think a term is excellent. I think, doing a year or 2 years is great. And I would leave that up to you guys to decide that that's time. So if you are interested in chairing or co-chairing, and you know so tonight, please feel free to raise your hand, and I'll take that information down. Everyone's not interested.
You have to maybe raise our hand publicly.
Okay, I was good.
And I said I wouldn't.
Okay, that's good. If it's just the two of you, then I will suggest we do a co-chair, but I'll let you guys have 2 more weeks to think if you email me. If not, let's just plan on the two of you sort of coming up, saying a few words, and then...
Can we coacher her and
yes,
like
yeah.
fight? Although
yeah,
we could fight and like...
Yeah, it's
going to
be a brawl.
Yeah,
Does the coach have authority
to snack? Oh my god, if we aren't snacked at this next meeting, we're going to mute.
Okay.
Yeah. Listen, seriously.
So you will have that response.
And there's the calendar.
Snacks? I
have to have a calendar for the next meeting. I'll get the agendas out earlier, materials out earlier to you guys as well.
Like a week.
But there are the next few dates. All meetings are here. There are a few, I can't remember which dates, but we move across the hall, but they're up in this.
I don't want Betty to grab all the power, but I'm in Texas August 24th, so,
oh,
you know,
and
I'm
in
that
I'm in Scotland on September.
Oh, co-chairs.
So we don't know where to do any work.
I know, exactly. Quickly going forward,
I'm going to advocate as well for bi-monthly meetings starting in 2017. The end of 2016, we got a lot of work, so I kind of put them in here now so we can get this all done. But I don't necessarily, unless we... I think we should start meeting bi-monthly, and then if we need to meet more, we can. But so that would be starting in February of 2017, and then going bi-monthly. If you want to plan ahead.